Hey, welcome back everyone to more D&D vlogs. And I actually finally got some amount of response from the couple of previous videos I did, which I didn't expect. A couple of you actually said that my last video helped you with character creation, and I didn't expect that, so I was just kind of talking about it from my standpoint, but if it helps you, awesome. That's great. In this episode, I'm going to primarily focus on campaign building. In the Dungeon Master Guide, they actually kind of have a pretty good chart as to what happens, but as I've already stated before in my first vlog, I'm not confident enough yet with my writing personally to write up an adventure from scratch. I have a few ideas that I'd like to implement that I could tie in to pre-written modules. And with that being said, once again, advertisement for DMSGuild.com. That is DMSGuild.com. That place has a lot of very well-written modules, once again, some of which are for free. And you can take a look at how those are made and how they're structured. Once again, referring to what I keep in here, all the previous stuff that I play with my current group. And I printed off a copy of the Giant Slayer campaign right here, which was just intended for 4 to 6 players. I think it's 4 to 6 players. 4 first level characters. And it's up, 3 to 4 hours of gameplay, depending on what you do and everything. So I basically took this, and it gives you the rundown over here, pretty much like what it is, who it's for, and all that good stuff. And I've already put a link in the very first video that I did for the series in the description, so I'll probably just put it again in this one, if anyone's just kind of watching these out of order, which is completely cool. But what I ended up doing with Giant Slayer, because once again, if you ever start a first campaign, or not your first campaign, but like your first D&D session, I feel more comfortable doing one that is a pre-written adventure. Once again, the reason being is because you don't know how your players will react to your world, and I didn't know how mine would with the world that we make together. But you don't know how the players would react, or what they would do, or anything. And if you have a pre-written module, it has most of everything that you really need to know set up for you. And from that point, they give you some ideas to play it by ear. And like I said before, I've tied in the Giant Slayer storyline into Lost Mine of Phandelver. And that's the thing, whenever you link these adventures together, it's not like that you could go from one pre-written module to the next, especially if they take place in different realms. Like, if you were to do the campaign that is a pre-written module that I'm just going to go ahead and grab here, a couple of them actually. Like, let's see, here we go. With these, the first one that they published for 5th edition was Horde of the Dragon Queen. I've actually went through this, and it's pretty damn awesome. The only problem is that for this one, Kobold Press, the people who published this one in particular, they didn't really label their maps effectively to where they have a map with a legend that says this is place number one, and it's a well that leads to an underground catacomb or something. Instead, they have the map out there. I'll show you an example. It's actually in the first chapter of this, or episode one, as it's called. Episode one, Greenest in Flames. Let's see here. They give you the encounters that you roll a d8 for random encounters. Like, if you roll a 1, you fight against 6 kobolds. And, yeah, those are wandering encounters. And it teaches you about that in the Mines of Phandelver adventure, which is awesome. But here we go. Greenest, right here. If you can kind of see that, not sure how well the webcam is. you can see how they have numbers there, but if you look in the text, it doesn't say what number is what. And that confused the heck out of me. If you ever go to Amazon and if you look up Horde of the Dragon Queen, a couple of the negative reviews actually mention that. You don't have a legend with your maps. This is bad. And a couple of people were basically whining about it. But if you actually read through the text, it tells you what each thing is and it's labeled. It's not conveniently labeled for you to quickly find, though. Like it is in their sequel, which is a continuation of Horde of the Dragon Queen to The Rise of Tiamat. And speaking of her, I got it right here. I got that little miniature because I thought she looked pretty cool. The Rise of Tiamat is, as it sounds, the cult of... Basically, let me read you the back here. The cult of the dragon leads the charge in an unholy campaign to bring Tiamat back to the Forgotten Realms. With the race against evil moving from Waterdeep to the Sea of Moving Ice to Thay, the situation grows more perilous with each passing moment. The heroes must succeed or Faerun will succumb to draconic tyranny. In the end, the world would never be the same. And it also says in the back, it's an adventure designed for characters between the levels of 8 to 15 following this right here. But anyways... As you heard from the description, this particular adventure is set in the Forgotten Realms. That's totally cool. A lot of people do like the Forgotten Realms preset universe. And as I've already stated before, with the group that I have, I don't really have a particular setting. It's like I mentioned before, I've borrowed some of the names of other towns or gods. And... here's another pre-written module that I bought. I've actually bought all the 5th edition ones so far, and I've read through some of them, and they're actually pretty awesome. Curse of Strahd, right here. This takes place in Barovia. And this is in the world of Greyhawk, I believe. It's either Greyhawk or Ravenloft. Let me read the back of it. Probably say it in here, but under raging storm clouds, the vampire Count Strahd von Zarovich stands silhouetted against the ancient walls of Castle Ravenloft. Rumbling thunder pounds the castle spires. The wind's howling increases as he turns his gaze down toward the village of Barovia. Far below, yet not beyond his keen eyesight, a party of adventurers has just entered his domain. Strahd's face forms the barest hint of a smile as his dark plan unfolds. He knew they were coming, and he knows why they came. All according to his plan. A lightning flash rips through the darkness, but Strahd is gone. Only the howling of the wind fills the midnight air. The master of Castle Ravenloft is having guests for dinner, and you are invited. And this is intended for levels 1 through 10 characters. But I'm fairly certain that this takes place in a different world setting or universe setting for D&D. And I want to say that is... I'm not sure if it's Ravenloft or if it... Well, Greyhawk or Ravenloft, I cannot remember. Sometimes it says, which I'm pretty sure that you could find out just by reading the introduction here. So here we go. Curse of Strahd is a story of gothic horror presented here in the D&D role-playing game adventure for 4 to 6 adventurers, level 1 through 10. A balance, character classes is helpful since the adventure. Let's see, this adventure is a retelling of the, it's a remake of the Ravenloft adventure, which was published in 1983 by TSR. In the years since, the original has gained a reputation, Yeah, it does take place in a different multiverse. The lands of Barovia are from the Forgotten World and the D&D multiverse, and this adventure gives glimpses of the world. So anyways, this is pretty much set in a different universe as opposed to this. This is Forgotten Realms. This is more Ravenloft, Greyhawk. I want to say it's Ravenloft. Anyways, because they're two different worlds and basically two different settings, the way that the pre-written modules is, you can't really do one, end that adventure, and start up the next one without there being a link in between, some kind of connection. I mean, you could totally have Tiamat in the same universe as Strahd here. That's fine. It's just that you need a good reason for it. Like, you have to pretty much brainstorm ideas. And what I ended up doing, once again, referring to my dearly beloved dwarf hunter, Hashter, I ended up using him as the main catalyst for the adventures. It started with him sending one of the party members a letter saying that he would require their help, and ironically enough, a giant strolled through the town that he was temporarily staying at, and they took care of business with that. And that gave me an opportunity to add my own characters to use later. It also served as an opportunity for, once again, it's a small, quick adventure, 2 to 4 hours of gameplay, 3 to 6 hours, whatever. It was a pretty good opportunity for all of the players, their characters, to introduce each other to one another and have a reason for why they're traveling together. Basically, I still don't know their story, actually. I told my players to come up... Okay, I gotta set my books down elsewhere. They're falling. Anywho, I did tell my players to essentially try to come up with a backstory for each other. Don't tell me what it is up until a point in the story happens where we have the downtime and we're basically chilling at an inn with a mug full of ale and we're just relaying our past character stories to each other. So I don't know how their characters really met before this adventure, but I know how they have been tied into the adventure using Hashter. And then at the end of that campaign, Hashter came clean and he confessed, "I really called you here for helping me deliver goods to a town known as Phandelver." Or Phandalin, I'm sorry. I just needed help with delivering these to Phandalin. And I presented it to the party. "Do you want to basically help me be a delivery boy?" They agreed to it, so that already tied in those two adventures together, and it's in the same universe for me anyways. So you could definitely take, like, all these gods from different universes and put them in yours. There's no restriction, and actually that's what I've been preferring to do, is sort of just create our own universe that, once again, borrows the names of these gods, of these locations, of these characters that we could use, if I ever wanted to, which, frankly, I do and I don't. Like, Strahd, Count Strahd, with my story and my vision that I have for the players, he doesn't really fit in, so you also have to make that make sense with yours. If you want to include the goddess Tiamat in your story, how would you do that? And you kind of have to sort of think about that and make it make sense in context, I guess, is what I'm trying to say. So with that being said, I still don't feel confident enough to write my own adventures from scratch. I have ideas that I would like to incorporate, but all of my ideas are like these big stories or like endgame material. Like, I thought of a way for... If you ever read the Rise of Tiamat adventure, which it's pretty awesome, like I've said before, you're basically trying to stop a cult from bringing a god into the world who is chaotic evil and will fuck shit up. You're trying to stop that. And it actually has at the very end of the... Pretty much the very, very end of the adventure, that's the climax. You're trying to pretty much stop them from conducting their ritual to bring Tiamat in. And if the party fails, she starts to come through the portal. And you have to either kill her or die trying. It literally boils down to that grand finale. So that made me kind of brainstorm a couple of ideas, like, how could a god also come into the world outside of using a ritual like that? Using the dragon masks is what they use in that adventure. So I started to think, and I thought of Warcraft in particular with the Dark Portal, where they linked Draenor, or Draenor, however you want to pronounce that, to Azeroth. So that's how the orcs, who were on their own planet, came to Azeroth. So basically the orcs were green, or brown-skinned aliens, who came to Azeroth. They weren't normal there originally, and that's how they got there. So I thought, you could always create a portal like that, which, once again, it's your story, so it's your rules how you would govern that. And once again, it still has to make sense with the rules. So how could you bring a god into the world outside of doing a ritual like what's done in the Forgotten Realms setting right there? And I personally had another thought with that, and I've recently been brainstorming this idea, and it is, what if they tried to bring a god back into our realm by, which I'm pretty sure this has already been done before, like, this is not original, and I just thought of it while thinking of the Rise of Tiamat campaign. What if they were to try and bring a god into the world using a catalyst because their body couldn't really make that transcension, or, you know, it could not travel between planes with the method they were doing, but the essence or the soul of the god could. But in order to do that, they would need a catalyst. They would need basically a living humanoid sacrifice of sorts to be the vessel for the soul and this essence of a god. And I had this thought for the story about that, that surely there's also more than one way to bring a god into the world from those stories. And that's one of the ideas I had, but in turn, that would also come up with some negative consequences. Like, if you were to bring an immortal god or goddess to the mortal realm using a mortal vessel, that would in turn make the immortal god or goddess now mortal. And that could play a huge part in that story. Like, maybe now from the bad guy or the antagonist point of view, crap, you brought me into this world, I used to be, you know, immortal, and now I can die. Good job, a-holes. Now let's get my power back. So, yeah. That's one of the ideas I've been brainstorming lately. So, anyways, going back to what I was talking about with writing your own campaigns or doing what I do and just sort of alter them, I've been making minor changes as well. So, let's go back to, once again, Giant Slayer. It's intended for 4 player characters. The game itself already gives the Dungeon Master an NPC to use, so that's 5 characters in total that are involved with fighting and the combat and everything. But due to the constraints that I had at the time, we had 3 player characters and Hashter, my character. So we had 4. I had to kind of nerf the monster stats that are used in there, like the satyrs, for example. Or later on, what else do they fight? I'm trying to think of it. Like the ice mephits, or mephites. I don't know how to pronounce that. I kind of nerfed their stats just a little bit. But also, keep in mind, if you ever alter a monster's stats to make them more powerful or weaker, this is going completely off topic from tabletop gaming, but I remember playing Tom Clancy's The Division. I hate that game. I hated it. I played it for an hour. I returned it for my money back. I got my money back. So, I hated The Division. To me, it was awful. I'm not, like, narking on people who like the game, because I have a few friends who personally play it, and yeah, they love it, but it's just not for me. Whenever I played that game, I noticed a theme. You would fight these normal-looking bosses that literally look no different from any of the other NPC enemies in the game. They all look the same. They are just basically a human with a bald head and a machine gun and, like, a life jacket or some armor. The bosses that look no different from all the other characters or enemies in that game are massive bullet sponges. You could shoot them in the head several times, and they're taking a fraction of their health. Like, and it's ridiculous. So, the other big piece of advice that I have to altering campaigns is, outside of altering the story and trying to link adventures, or if you're going to incorporate things, it has to kind of make sense with your own world. Which, I mean, if you think about it, it's a world where you can shoot fireballs out your butthole if you want to. And, you know, that's logical. If you do it right. But whenever you alter monster stats, don't make them bullet sponges. Don't make it to where it's like you're fighting a brown bear and it's got 200 health, but its other stats are not different. It doesn't have different attacks. It doesn't have any other special abilities. It doesn't have an altered armor class. You know, you get the idea. So, if you're going to nerf or buff certain monsters, you have to do it outside of just making them a bullet sponge, is what I like to call them. Because otherwise, there's no challenge to it. There's really nothing to be added outside of, I hit it with the sword again. Oh boy, I have to do this 40 more times and we win. Because that's dull, that's boring, it's not fun. But if you were to take that brown bear, and if you were to alter it to where it, outside of the fact that it has slightly more health, you know, maybe it's pretty much the equivalent of a dire bear. Maybe outside of it, you know, having a little bit more health or more attacks, maybe it's like a phase spider, to where they could phase in and out. Maybe it's like a phase bear that has that teleport ability. Or maybe it has, you know, the multi-attack. It makes two attacks with the claws and one with its bite, which I think that they already do that. But, you know, make them have another effect. Like, they have poison claws, and that's something that, you know, range fighters are going to be like, I want to stay away from that because I don't want to get poisoned. So you kind of have to change the stats. But also keep in mind that whenever you alter their stats like that, you have to alter the challenge rating. So if you have a challenge rating 3 monster, and if you nerf it to where it's a challenge rating 1, but you don't do that experience right with that, you basically gave your character, you gave the players a challenge rating of 3 experience points for something that they killed that should have been 1. And I actually made that mistake during the first adventure that we did with Giant Slayer. I did nerf a couple of the stats with the ice methods, but I didn't, once again, change the challenge rating, and therefore the experience allocated to the party. So, once again, if you're gonna change the story, this is my first hint, or not hint, I guess like my first clue. If you're gonna change the story, that's cool. If you want to link the multiverses together, that is also cool, because it's yours, it is your players, you're making this together. You just have to have a way to link adventures to where it makes sense, because you can't be in the Forgotten Realms setting and immediately jump over to Dragonlance or Ravenloft was what it was. You can't just jump from one location to another. Like, if you have the adventure ends in Neverwinter and then the next one immediately starts in Waterdeep, it can't just be like, all right, the show ended here at Neverwinter and next one starts. You guys are now in Waterdeep. How did they get to Waterdeep? Why are they in Waterdeep? You have to have, you know, someone basically say, I need to send you to Waterdeep so that way you can investigate, you know, this cult of the dragon. And then they would go investigate that, and you would have to give them a good motivation to. So that's one of the tips I have for this one, is if you're gonna do it, it kind of has to make sense. The other tip that I've already given is the altering of monster stats. And appropriately, their challenge rating. And also keep in mind that if you buff a monster outside of making them a bullet sponge, once again, a higher challenge rating. And if you need tips on how to do challenge ratings and altering them, there are a few good guides online, but I personally, what I do is I go through the monster manual, and like I said, if you want to alter that bear to where now it's got like poison claws, or it's a phase bear or dire bear essentially, which I think that dire bears do exist already, but if you want to alter the stats to where it's a little bit better, maybe it's like a bear that can dig underground too, or give it wings, it's a flying bear. And now we're playing Legend of Zelda. We're playing this game, Oracle of Ages, with your flying bear. The blue one, too. I have not played that game in so long. Actually, it's just ironic that it was sitting over there. I've been playing with the Retron 5, and that was one of the games I played. So, anywho, with that association of changing the stats, what I do is I look at other monsters of the same challenge rating. I look at what makes them a good challenge. And for the longest time, I did not understand what challenge rating meant. A challenge rating is, if it is a challenge rating of 1, it is a fair challenge to 4 player characters of that same level. So, if you want, which I think that goblins are 1/4 of a challenge rating, they're either 1/4 or 1/8. I don't remember off the top of my head, but I have the monster manual somewhere around here. I don't have it on me. Never mind. I have another bag, and I keep, like, the player's handbook, the Dungeon Master's Guide, monster manual. I keep those in it. Because whenever I go to my sessions, you want those handy. So, anyways, I look at other monsters with the challenge rating, and I kind of dictate, well, what makes them that much of a challenge? And you can kind of pretty much gauge about what you would want with that. And if you're ever having a fight with the players and things are going poorly for them, or they're going too well, you can make it up on the fly. And once again, I did that with Giant Slayer. The final climax, the end encounter of that adventure, is the party fights Jaeger Bonecruncher. This is a party that is between levels 1 and 2 now. They're not going to be ready to take on a hill giant, which is a challenge rating of 5. However, prior to starting it, the party can set up traps to where he takes 12 points of damage per trap, essentially. And Jaya the Giant Slayer, or in my story, Thoric, helps fight the giant. So the encounter started like this. Pretty much, Jaeger fell for all 3 traps. So immediately at the very start of the fight, he took 36 points of damage. And I don't remember how much health that he has right offhand, but I, once again, Dungeon Master notebook here. I do still have it. Oh. My post-it notes, too. These are very handy, by the way, for Dungeon Masters. Post-it notes. Get them. So you can write quick notes down, and if you have your Dungeon Master screen, you can stick them on there in case if you need something to remember later. So, anywho, let me go to my list of printed off monsters. Alright, here we go. Yeah, another thing that I would suggest is if you can get a PDF copy or even type up monster stats, I suggest doing that, especially if they will be encountering those, like these right here. That's the bugbear stat. And in the current adventure with Mines of Phandelver, my altered version, they fight these a lot. And actually in the normal version, the not altered one, they fight them a lot too. So you always want to make sure that you have monster stats printed off and ready to go. So, anywho, let me go on ahead and double check here. Here we go. Hill Giants. Once again, if you don't happen to have a monster manual handy, you at least want your quick cheat sheets for monster stat. So the Hill Giant is a CR of 5, like I said, and he has, on average, 105 hit points. So what ended up happening was he took 36 points of damage, so already, like, the fight didn't go as challenging as I was hoping it would. Whenever he hit about a halfway mark, I gave him a new ability, just, I thought of it like that, just on the fly. I made him basically get really, really pissed and roar at the party, and I had them all make a wisdom saving throw, and two of them failed. I inflicted the fear stat on them. In particular, it was two of my players, or it was two of the players that did not have ranged attacks. And with the fear stat, they cannot move closer to that target for 1 minute. But at the start of each of their turns, they can remake the wisdom saving throw and try to do it. So, pretty much because the fight was going a little bit too easy, in my opinion, for the party, I ended up giving him that secondary ability. And whenever he hit a fourth of his health, I borrowed another ability from the fighter class. With the fighter class, you can use a second ability, or it is an ability called Second Wind. And that allows you to roll I think it's your hit die, and you recover that much health, and it's a bonus action. But you can only use it once between long rests, I believe. I pretty much gave the Hill Giant that, and I rolled his hit die. I rolled two of them in particular, which is D12. The hit die for the Hill Giant is 10 D12 plus 40. So at most, this thing can have 160 HP, which I probably should have did that just to make it a little bit more challenging, but once again, I didn't want a chance making it a bullet sponge. So whenever he was knocked down to about a fourth or a fifth of his health, I did that for him, and he regained some of his hit points back, and it made it a little bit more of a challenge for the players, because a couple of them are in a feared state, so they can't run towards this guy. They can only back away from it. And as a result, they couldn't really attack it. So that was a little bit more of a challenge. And so they had to try and think of other ways to, how can they still be useful in this fight? Because this Hill Giant's mostly focusing on my NPC, Thoric. And that's how it's actually written in the module. So it kind of gives them, you can create these abilities on the fly like that. And that's what I ended up doing to make the fight last a little bit longer, and it was just slightly more challenging. Because, you know, a couple of them are in a feared state, so they can't really move up and close to it to smack it with their sword. And he regained just a few hit points. But I didn't make it to where it was broken. I didn't make it to where he rolled, like, 8 12-sided die to recover that. I only made it, like, 2 or 3, if I remember right. I think it was 2. And I added his constitution modifier, which is plus 4. So I think that in total he recovered like 18 or 19 hit points in that round. I don't remember it off the top of my head. So anyways, you could also do that to, if a fight's going a little bit too easy for your player characters, you could give them abilities like that. If it's going a little bit more difficult for them, you could make it to where maybe they have an exploited weakness that they just now found, or maybe an arrow shoots from afar, and it's basically like, we'll just say it was Legolas, the Elven Ranger, or, you know, the elf, just an Elven Ranger, in the forest happened to see them fighting this thing, and it's just like, they're in danger, I'ma help them. You could do that. Not always, though. Once again, the way that I view this as more than a game, I also view it as collaborative storytelling. And that brings me to another point that I would like to talk about. It's still a game. You don't want to make this to where your player characters feel invincible. You want to use things like that sparingly to where you will play merciful with them, but not always. If they make a stupid decision, make that decision punishing. You don't want it to seem like they have plot armor. You really don't. So you want to make the threat of death very real to them. And I myself, I'm still kind of having difficulty figuring that one out. Because once again, I'm still a newbie DM, and this is just my personal experience and what I've thought of and what I've experienced. Or at least watched videos of. So let's say that, you know, this hill giant suddenly has an advantage on them. Maybe one of the hunters in the village suddenly pretty much saw that this, you know, Thoric was getting his ass kicked, and he took a stand to shoot at his eye, and it hit. Maybe that would make him blind in one eye, and that would give the players the incentive, shoot his other eye. You don't want to flat out tell them out of character, shoot his eyes, he'll get blind. You want to make it a hint that they should think about that, think outside the box. And with that, I always encourage my players to be creative with their attacks. Be descriptive. Tell me what body part you're aiming for. Don't just say, I shoot an arrow at him. Because if that's the case, I'm assuming that you just shoot at his torso. You're not shooting at a particular body part. And on that note, one of the players, she loves hitting the testicular area on a lot of male foes. If you have a character, or if you have a player that does that, let them. Never tell your players no. Unless if it's incredibly, incredibly silly. Like, I want to try to catch this cannonball. In which case, you could say you could certainly try. It is probably going in too well for you. And I wouldn't suggest it. But this one player likes to hit things in the groin. For guys out there watching this, that's a hell of a weakness. And it really is. With that, I personally roll a constitution saving throw, and I make it a pretty decent difficulty DC. DC is... What is it? CR is challenge rating. Yeah, DC is a difficulty challenge. Or difficult, whatever. I usually make these things roll a saving throw with like a DC of 15. Sometimes 20, depending on if it's like a critical, I'm just going to say, yeah, you smash those things, man. They're stunned. But if they succeed in the constitution saving throw, they basically, it's just like, oh, that hurt. I'm sucking in the pain, though. But if they fail the constitution saving throw, make that punishing, like, who? That hurt. So they're going to sit there, they're basically stunned, and they're going to, you know, like, protect their family jewels. So, you know, reward creativity like that. If they try to shoot at their eyes, let them roll, like, a dexterity saving throw to see if they barely dodge out of the way and it, like, hit their cheek or something with an arrow. Just... You have to kind of think in the situation, how would this react to try and dodge it or withstand the blow? And go from there. And I kind of realized that this was going about talking with altering campaigns or stories to talking about monsters and players smacking their crotch. That's one heck of a degrade, don't you think? So, that being said, I have altered the Mines of Phandelver campaign to where at the very beginning, it's called Part 1 or Chapter 1, Goblin Arrows. And this assumes that the party's on level 1. So, fighting goblins as a standard level 1 enemy, that's very common. That's actually very well recommended. But because the player started this adventure whenever they were on level 2, I didn't want them to just fight regular goblins, because if they're a challenge rating of 1/4, they're going to very easily decimate these poor bastards. So I decided to change it up a little bit, and I didn't want to make it to where I increased all of the stats for all the goblins. Like, I didn't make it to where these goblins did push-ups for days, so they're pretty swole, they're jacked, they've been hitting the gym, and they have, you know, more health. I wanted to change this story a little bit and justify the introduction of my character whose name I borrowed, once again, Slurry. I wanted to kind of justify him being part of the group, and once again it made sense with the context of the story. Slurry was that goblin wizard. They're very, very, very rare, because most goblins use scimitar and a shield, and they run at stuff and smack it, or they shoot arrows and hide. So I changed the story to where the primary antagonist of part one were goblins and bugbears. Or not goblins, hobgoblins. Hobgoblins and bugbears. They pretty much had taken over Cragmaw Hideout, and they spared the goblins that were living there under the pretense that they are basically their slaves now. And not all goblins complied, and a few of them died as a result. So the primary antagonist, I thought about looking at the hobgoblins, I also looked at the bugbears, and those being used in conjunction with each other was actually pretty much of a good challenge. So for the first chapter, I replaced the four goblins that attack the caravan with two hobgoblins sitting in trees, shooting with arrows, and two bugbears that ran up and got close and personal to the investigators of two dead horses sitting out in front of the road. So that's another way that you can do some encounter building, is look at monster stats and their abilities and see how well they play off of each other. And that worked out pretty well. Up until one of the hobgoblins was shot out of a tree, failed a dexterity saving throw, and just fell to his death because a cleric shot Sacred Flame at him and he didn't dodge it. And he fell. So that killed him. And that's pretty much that. I shouldn't have started recording this so late at night because now I'm very tired. And I've been ranting for like 40 minutes on all this. So let me just go ahead and recap what I talked about. The first thing is, you have to always link adventures, and it has to make sense. If you're going to make any alterations, you kind of have to rewrite it to where it could make sense in your world, or it would make sense. Second thing that I talked about is altering monsters by making them stronger or weaker, and do not forget to alter the challenge rating accordingly. Don't cheat your players out of experience, but don't over-reward them if they didn't earn it. And the third one that I really talked about was with pretty much just more encounter building and ideas on how you can alter stories outside of just making one particular monster go to a gym for days. I mean, if you have one that's like that, that would make sense because they do have, like, higher stat blocks for goblins, and they are called a goblin boss. You could utilize that instead if you wanted to, but I think that they're a challenge rating of 3, so it says my party was on level 2, I didn't really want to do that. So anyways, just keep those in mind as you yourself alter campaigns or write your own. Me personally, I'm kind of altering them and I'm finding ways to tie them into each other. And even if that means that I have to kind of rework the story a little bit by cutting out things or adding my own things. And eventually, I'm sure that will also help build my confidence level with writing my own full-blown adventure. So I'd love to say thank you all for watching this series I started up recently, and if this helped you out at all, I'm glad it did. Just don't forget to check out a couple of other videos that are out on YouTube, and my favorite two in particular were the GM tips from Matthew Mercer on the Geek and Sundry channel and Pro Jared's D&D Simber videos. Those two really helped me out, and listening to Spoonie with his Counter Monkey series, that also helped out a lot with thinking about it. So, anywho, I appreciate you all watching, and may your rolls be ever in your favor. Take care, everyone, and have a good night.